This is allocated for the class called the topography of the path. Basically, the map we are talking or inquiring into the entire map of Buddhist teaching, 84,000 Buddhist teaching, and summarized into this quite unique and beautiful map. So we started looking at the map little by little, but not just observing map. Oh, this looks interesting. Oh, this place is interesting to go. Not like that. Really challenging, because it's about us, each of us. We have to inquire into our own life, you know, how that fits into what that means. You know, we just came into this place called refuge. We started to really inquire into what refuge means, and also what taking refuge means to each of us. Of course, there are lots of literature about that, and the Ramlim classic talks about all these things, but it's very important to really embody what we are reading and what we are studying. Or this has been a little bit challenging, I think, purposely. I don't know how you guys are finding. Refuge is not about a concept, as we all know. Refuge is something we do. So I thought that today I'm going to talk a little bit about the advantages of having taken refuge, because that really inspired us. No? First of all, what does taking refuge entail? No. We said we take refuge to Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. So last time we talked about inner refuge and the so-called outer refuge, or internal refuge and the external refuge. Those things really need to be clarified. In order to really connect to the internal refuge, we need external refuge. We are not awakened being. We are just like a little tiny fragile plant. If we are really able to connect in a refuge, we don't need outer refuge. You know, if we really rest in this true refuge, Buddha nature, Buddha mind within us, complete confidence, and then able to rest it, not just glimpse it, able to rest it. Then we don't need a picture, we don't need a reminder, we don't need. Perhaps may not need a teacher either, but teacher is the one who really pointing out, so may need it, especially on the tantric path, as well as Mahamudra and Dzogchen. We need a teacher, not a book. So external refuge is important as well. We don't want to prematurely just internalize everything. You know, in the West, we have a tendency to do that. And I don't need anything, those external stuff. But for example, Buddha is the one who really showed us what's possible, no? Then when we look at the Buddha's picture, or Buddha means awakened being, not necessarily Shakyamuni Buddha form, but Magic Lapton awakened being, then remind us, no? Our own true nature, the connection to the awakened. We have this thread of that. That's very precious. So it's nice to have those reminders. More reminders, the better. Then as we progress or get used to it on this path, then less external. We get used to it just before we eat something. Automatically, we offer to the Buddha. So, anyway, what does the taking refuge entail? Taking refuge is the core orientation, no? New kind of orientation. Orientation that we put in our lives. So that when our orientation becomes stable, see, then we don't need to shop around. You know, we don't need to look for other refuge here and there. Really, those people who are stable in terms of refuge, very spiritually stable, no? And happy. Did you notice that? You know, I used to hang out with the Tibetan people, Tibetan teacher, elderly who fled from Tibet. They are so spiritually stable. They're not like moving around here and there to try to find something more interesting. Nothing like that, really, because they have a refuge, this unshakable trust, entrusting oneself to something greater than this small self, small island of self. Then they know what they are doing with their lives. No question. You know, we in the West, we have like, oh, what should I do? I'm not sure. I don't know what going on in my life or something like that. That sort of question doesn't occur. And also, where my life is going, you know, like a direction, you know, GPS. Those kind of questions not going to occur because refuge is the set once refuge is stable. And also this question of purpose, you know, what the purpose of my life or something like that. Yeah, we ask, right? But the refuge, it's very clear, no? Of course, the temporary purpose and the ultimate purpose, right? Both are important. We should not ignore the temporary purpose, you know, being kind to your friend, people around you, really cultivate your good heart to all the people around you. That's very important. And but then at the same time, we go like a higher purpose. Ultimate purpose, which is not conditioned, you know, does not come and go. Refuge is the ongoing willingness to surrender as well. So there are two aspects, no? Surrendering and also entrusting oneself to something beyond the self. Surrendering also, not passive, but more like a relaxing into. When we meditated, I don't know how you felt about it. Like relax into your back body, you already have this support. That's the feeling, like a felt sense. Like you felt kind of relaxed, no? So that might be a little bit of sense of refuge. Relaxing into, surrendering into something greater, great wisdom. And also you are doing, entrusting that true nature within you. And then walking with it. You know, emanating the light, helping all sentient beings. That is the expression of your refuge. Refuge is something you do, you know, you do what the Buddha taught. You know, true refuge, ultimate refuge, or Dharma refuge. Dharma refuge is the realization and the path, those two things. I mean, there are many ways to talk about it, but that's count, no? You know, what do you come to know true for sure. So you, Dharma refuge is in your mind, you understand, come to realize, yes, this is true. What the Buddha said is true. I tested. I know it from the guts. So that's the Dharma refuge. That's the trustable thing, unshakable. Anyway, so that's that. Yeah. So putting meaningful direction into our lives. So basically, this is the basic orientation of lives. So I wanted to talk 8 advantages of having taken refuge, which come from the classic text. But I think you can maybe reflect on your life. Is that your experience? First one is become an inner being. That's number. Number is the Tibetan term. I think I talked somewhere. Nam means inner being. So before there was a external orientation, outer, no? We take refuge for this and that, you know, still maybe your bank account and even your partner and mother. I mean, nothing wrong with that, but that is not ultimate refuge. Once you take refuge, you become an inner being. You are looking the answer within, not the outside of you. Ultimately, mother doesn't give you the ultimate refuge. You know that one. So then the second one is have gained the basis of future vows. So when we talk about vows, like a commitment or vows, you know, refuge vow, I'm not going to go over those, review those refuge vows, but once you take refuge, then we have a vow. So vow means staying in your mind. So then that is the basis of Bodhisattva vow, Mahayana vow, and Mahayana vow is the basis of Vajrayana vow, which means without refuge, there's no Bodhisattva vow, no Vajrayana vow. I mean, this is obvious, but I have to remind ourselves that one. Because sometimes we kind of, okay, I'm a Vajrayana practitioner, so, you know, refuge is so fundamental, you know, I don't need to review the what the refuge entails, you know, so that's not so good. Refuge is so important, basis of Vajrayana. Most of us practice Vajrayana or Mahayana practice, Mahayana ideal. This is the basis. Then number 3 is purify the past negative karmic imprint. That's obvious. Because if ants take refuge, then we follow or we take vows, right? One of the vows, for example, not harming. For example, if we take refuge in Dharma, basic one is not harming and so forth. Those things really protect you and purify you. And also quickly accumulate vast amount of merit by taking refuge. Refuge stay in your mind. For example, I think every morning we do that, refuge and bodhicitta. And then on that day, rest of the day is imbued by the refuge bar. So in that means when you do something, as little as, for example, as I said, when just before you drink a cup of tea, we offer to the Buddha or the Buddha Dharma Sangha, three refuge, for the sake of all sentient beings, that's much better. Then that means you are accumulating tremendous good karma, positive potential, especially if you visualize all being surrounded and offering. And as a Vajrayana practitioner, if you offer the deity living within our body, amazingly, we can accumulate a tremendous amount of so-called positive potentials. So that is number four. Then number five is cannot be harmed by human or non-humans. So this one, interesting, huh? Refuge is a protection, one of the best protection you can have. Like when we think about protection, like we have to have a very fierce barricade against you. And no, refuge is a real protection, because mind is a protection. In those Asian countries, when the disaster happened, right? For example, at the time of the tsunami in Thailand, people are Buddhist, right? Then they always recite a refuge formula. Big group, they are reciting this refuge. They are surrendering into the protection, under the protection of those refuge, Buddhas, awakened beings that entrusted. That's become a protection. There is that sort of customs. It's a very beautiful practice, refuge is. And at the time of the death, all these elements started to dissolve and the wind started to disintegrate. Then many chaotic phenomena appeared, right? Fear arise. At that time, if we have a refuge, if we really cultivated, we walked on the refuge during the time when our body is still warm, then at that time, when rest of that started to disappear, but then refuge protects you. I entrust myself to this refuge. Whatever happens, then joyfully, I call dying into luminosity. Mm. So that's very important. So not harmed by human and non-human. Then sixth one is that we'll not fall into miserable state. In Buddhist tradition, traditionally it's called the lower lamps. In this case, I said miserable states, mental states. We can talk more about that, what that means in a modern context. But we'll not fall into miserable states or lower lamp, lower rebirth, if you believe in rebirth. That's one advantage. Then seventh, is your virtuous purposes will easily fulfilled. Again, if you have a refuge, then refuge makes everything possible if it's virtuous, because Buddha is supporting you, guiding you. Were you able to feel into this awake presence? Buddha mind is omnipresent. Every molecule is made of Buddha and air here. It's kind of weird thinking, right? Thinking to that way. But the Buddha, once they awakened, they don't disappear into Lala Land. Their only purpose is to help us. Just we need to open it. We need to connect it from our side. They are ready to help. They are always ready. When we are ready, they are ready. Last one is we'll quickly attain awakening. That those are the advantages. This is a big subject, so we continue to inquire. Continue to think about it. And how does that apply to my life? To which extent I'm truly entrusting myself to the three refuge, Sedo Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. What does that mean? you know, there are a lot of literature. So if you like, you can study a little bit, you know, beautiful. They talk about all the qualities of Buddha, quality of Dharma, quality of Sangha. We didn't have time to go over all these things, but at your own pace, you contemplate on then what that entails. Mm-hmm.